You go into Kensington Gardens at Queen's Gate, past the statue of General Sir Charles Napier, the Victorian hero. King Henry VIII seized the land in 1536 when he abolished the monasteries and made it into a deer hunting ground. The flower walk is carefully maintained by the gardeners to give flowers for most of the year. It's full of small birds, like this robin. And a blackbird is singing, the sign of an English spring. The little owls are much admired by visitors. When you stare at them, they stare back. The song thrush is singing, the male of a pair nesting here. An owl has to take time out for preening. The Albert Memorial is not really a building, it's a giant version of a medieval reliquary. Prince Albert is holding the catalogue of the Great Exhibition of 1851, his idea. A missel thrush is singing. The statue groups on the corners represent four continents. This is America, complete with a buffalo, the spirit of the land. We go back across the flower walk to the Round Pond and Kensington Palace. Every Sunday there is a race for model yachts. They are radio controlled and follow a tight course around marker buoys. The statue of Queen Victoria was made by her daughter Princess Louise, an amateur sculptor. She wears what Daisy Ashfoot called a small but costly crown. The sunken garden, surrounded by pergolas of roses, not yet in bloom, is part of the palace's private garden. A pair of moorhens nest here. This year they have made their nest in a clump of reeds. A robin is singing in an ornamental holly bush. And a goldfinch is singing in a treetop. We leave the palace grounds and go past the Round Pond. Some Egyptian geese have had another family. They have no idea of the northern seasons and breed when they feel like it. It's a cold day, and the chicks need to shelter under their mother. It also keeps them safe from these hungry, lesser black-backed gulls. But it's a dangerous life for a young bird. We go over the long water. A gardener planted these cowslips long ago, and they come up every year. A blackbird is preening in the sun. A Chetty's warbler is singing, a bird that came to Britain only 40 years ago. Thank you. A pair of magpies are courting. The female needs the male to bring her food when she's on her nest. She flutters her wings to imitate a young bird begging for food to see if he will respond. You can hear a great spotted woodpecker drumming in the background. Here's another family of Egyptian geese in a sheltered spot near the bridge. We go under the bridge to enter Hyde Park. There are many Persian expats in Kensington, and they are Zoroastrians. They celebrate their new year at the spring solstice by growing clumps of wheat or lentils, and at the beginning of April they throw them into the lake, where they are eaten by mute swans and moorhens. A great crested grebe is fishing near the bridge. It's one of a pair nesting on the Kensington Gardens side of the bridge. The nest needs to be defended against intruders. This is a territorial display. The grebe catches a small fish. A long view of the same nest from the bridge. The parents take turns sitting on the eggs, and they cooperate in caring for the chicks when these emerge later. Red-crested pochards are large diving ducks. A pair of drakes are fighting. With ducks, the showier the male, the more aggressive he is. This is a hybrid of a common pochard and a tufted duck. There are two on the lake, both female. Another hybrid, this time of a Canada goose and a greylag goose. Time for a wash to keep its feathers in good shape. The greylag has the same idea. So does a coot. But a mute swan makes the biggest splash. Feral pigeons also enjoy a bath. Two mandarin drakes are washing as well. So is an Egyptian goose. The pair of Egyptians displaying to each other make a tremendous racket. The pair of gadwalls take no notice of the kerfuffle. Black swan has been here for 6 months now. No one knows where he came from, but he seems to have escaped from another park as he's very tame and will feed from your hand. After some flirting, he has settled down with a mute swan girlfriend, though she's still too young to breed. This is his threat display, telling the other swans to keep away. The other swans didn't understand it at first, but they do now, after he attacked most of them. Then he gives his come-on call to his girlfriend, and they cruise off to feed together. We've gone round the lake, and now we're back in Kensington Gardens. A green woodpecker is excavating a nest hole in the plane tree. You can hear a nuthatch trilling in the background. People come from far and wide to feed the rose-ringed parakeets. The birds are fond of fruit, and so are the grey squirrels. Great tits will feed from your hand too. Their song can be heard everywhere in the park. This is an old trick for photographing fast-moving birds. You set up a bit of branch and put seeds on it, then train the camera on the spot and wait. And with luck, you will get pictures of great tits. And blue tits. And coal tits. And if you're lucky, a nuthatch. Jays will come down too. And eat all the seeds before leaving. A coal tit is singing from a treetop. Here's a black cap. And a chaffinch calling. Long-tailed tits zoom around in flocks. This is a tree creeper running up an oak tree, looking for insects and cracks in the bark. The number of herring gulls in the park has gone up a lot in the past few years. Sometimes there are over 100. The young gulls like to play with sticks and stones and any small objects they find. They pick them up and drop them and catch them again. This is useful practice for one of their ways of feeding, which is to chase birds carrying food, pester them till they drop it, and catch the falling food in mid-air. Oh! Mandarins escaped from park collections of ornamental ducks and are now breeding in the wild. They nest in holes in trees. One of the best things about this park is that there's no collection of captive ornamental birds. All the birds are here because they want to be. Mallards often show colour variation and can be any colour from white to black. The female mallard is blonde with the normal pattern on her feathers in a lighter colour. Two male tufted ducks are strangely obsessed with a female mallard, following her about and chasing each other away to be alone with her. Here's a tufted duck with a mate of his own species. They're diving ducks, feeding on small invertebrates and water plants. Coots build strong nests of twigs on submerged branches. As long as the nest is in use, they keep adding twigs so that the nest may grow to enormous size. Herons wait for hours for fish to pass by, but eventually they lose patience. A pair of beautiful shire horses visit from time to time to give demonstrations of old farming methods. The Italian garden, with its marble fountain, was added in 1860 by Prince Albert. It's often used as a backdrop for wedding photographs. The garden was part of an improvement scheme, in which the polluted Westbourne River, which used to feed the lake, was diverted around the north of the park. The lake is now fed from a borehole, and the water is quite clean. The lake is full of fish, carp, perch, roach, bream, and the odd pike. Some of the carp weighed 25 pounds. This is the dominant mute swan on the long water, doing a threat display to chase intruding swans back under the bridge and onto the Serpentine. He and his mate are nesting on a small artificial island that was made for them a couple of years ago. At present they have four eggs. Coot has also nested on the island. The swans don't like this, but have to put up with it. The coots hatched four chicks. Here they are seen from the balustrade of the Italian garden, with the parents bringing bits of algae. A pair of Canada geese are nesting in a nearby reed bed. We're now going along the east side of the long water, on the left of this view. This shelter is used mainly for martial arts practice, but there's always time for a dancing lesson. Starlings nest in the eaves of the shelter. This one is on the roof, singing. Starling song is an odd mixture of sounds with imitations of other birds. They range around the surrounding bramble patches and grass in search of worms and grubs. This one has found a larva but discards it. Perhaps it is a distasteful one of a species that has evolved to avoid being eaten by birds. The Henry Moore Arch stands on the vista, the view from the front of Kensington Palace. Rabbits graze on the grass surrounding it, and jackdaws poke around looking for worms and beetles. This female blackbird has white patches on her face. Some blackbirds have more white and may even be white all over. There's another little owl in the lime tree just up the hill. Herons often perch in treetops, looking over the surrounding area for the chance of a meal, but a stiff breeze can make it hard to stay put. It's calmer down by the water. There aren't many amphibians in the park. This common toad was on the tarmac at the edge of the Serpentine, where it had probably been accidentally dropped by a heron. I took it up to the private garden of the ranger's lodge and dropped it over the fence at the edge of the little pond. The park police station is next door. The park is still lit by gas, and this is the biggest lamp post. This is a memorial to the naturalist William Henry Hudson, who studied the park wildlife. He was better known as a novelist, and in 1904 he published his bestseller Green Mansions, about a lost tribe in the South American rainforest. The hero falls in love with the beautiful tribal girl Rima, who dresses in spider's webs and knows the language of the birds. Here she is, interpreted by Jacob Epstein, with no dress and looking a bit lumpy. There's a small fountain under the relief, and it's a popular bathing spot for birds such as this wood pigeon. In memory of Hudson, some areas of the park were fenced off as wildlife sanctuaries. One of them is on the east side of the Long Water. It's full of all kinds of small birds, and also rabbits. These young ones are the latest addition to the population. They are on the edge of their burrow. A pair of wood pigeons are also feeling the urge to get together. This wood pigeon is drinking in the pool in the dell, another of Hudson's sanctuaries. It's full of flowering trees and shrubs, and this magnolia is being enjoyed by a parakeet. You can hear a coltit singing. The dell is at the east end of the Serpentine. The lake was created by damming the Westbourne River to flood its valley, and by looking down from the top of the dam. You go round the side of the enclosure admiring the bluebells to see the waterfall from below, where the water finds its original level before flowing down to the Thames. Before the lake was made, the Serpentine was a flat valley floor with a meandering stream and fish ponds, originally used by the monks of Westminster Abbey to provide their Friday meals. Now it's a lake where you can hire a boat and row around as competently as you can manage. If you can't row, hire a peddler. The moored boats are used by pied wagtails as stations from which they can dart out to seize passing insects. This Dennis fire engine belongs to the Students' Union of Imperial College. They are celebrating its 100th birthday. The union owns an even older car, a 1902 James and Brown, still drivable. In 2002, it was successfully driven to Paris, interrupted only by a stop to completely rebuild the engine. Beside the Serpentine, Matt shows us a few elegant moves on quad skates. Starling is nesting in a hole in the plane tree near one of the boathouses. A pair of mute swans built a nest next to one of the boathouses behind a fence. It was felt not to be safe enough and they were evicted. They crossed the lake to a new site. People dump all kinds of strange and unsuitable food for the birds. However, many birds seem to like spaghetti. Several pairs of herons are nesting in the trees on the Serpentine Island. It's hard to see what they're up to, but there are signs that chicks may be hatching. This is where the evicted swans went, inside the net intended to protect a reed bed. It's not a bad sight, though a determined fox could gnaw through the netting. A gap between two floating baskets of water plants provides a nest site for a pair of coots. The Lido is a year-round bathing area on the south shore of the Serpentine. There's also a restaurant here whose patrons can sit out on the terrace when the wildly changeable British weather allows it. Several mandarins have come up here from the long water. These are both drakes. Probably the females are on their nests in tree holes. There is also another family of Egyptian geese at risk from the many herring gulls in this exposed spot. In warm weather, children paddle in the shallow water of the Diana Memorial Fountain. As a robin sings, we go past the bridge and back into Kensington Gardens. And a blackbird gives us a farewell song as we reach Queen's Gate. Walk out into busy Kensington Road to return to the park another day.